What we get into is what we use mostly, and what the class is about, is alternating current. Now, alternating current can be stepped down, up or down really easily. You run it through a transformer, you step it up, or you run it through a transformer, you step it down. It's very efficient. You can go from 120 volts up to 300. You can take 120 down to 6 volts. You just get a transformer, run it through that transformer. You can step it up or down. It's very efficient, works really well. You can vary it easily in small increments, which is something that's really hard to do with DC, and it's much more efficient to do it with AC. You can run AC for really long distances, hundreds and hundreds and hundreds and thousands of feet for AC without losing it. Okay, it's the standard everywhere across the country, you know, which is really nice. It's very efficient. You can have plenty of power available to it, and almost anything we have will run on it. Just about everything we have will run on AC. And it's easily isolated between lighting, sound, and video, and that's important. And we'll go over that if we have time later on when we're looking at sound power. Now, there are some disadvantages to AC. Mostly it's pretty high voltage and current, so it's dangerous. Okay, where we're running it, we're doing these 120 volt and 208 volt systems. That's a lot of voltage. And if it isn't handled properly, that is enough to kill you. And it doesn't take much electricity to go through your heart and stop it. Okay, so it is dangerous. You can't run portable devices on AC because you can't store AC in a battery. You can only store DC in a battery. And it's subject to swings in level and quality. That's another disadvantage of it. It's not real clean power, and you're kind of beholden to the power company. It's easily corrupted. You know, a motor turns on somewhere, it sends a spike through your system. Coffee machine turns on somewhere, you get noise and audio, you know. Controlling it can create problems, and we'll see some of that when it gets into audio. That's mostly an audio issue. And sometimes you don't have enough. You know, if you've ever been on and out where there's a power failure, it's really a bummer, you know. You're trying to get these chain motors out of the ceiling and you don't have any power. And you gotta, you know, this happened once at Blossom where they had to get the generator in there or hook that all up. And, you know, it was like this nightmare, you know. So you're kind of beholden to the power company, and sometimes you don't have enough of it to do what you want to do because there could be a power failure, you know. What we use it for is lighting, sound, and video, okay? We use it for chain motors because we have to. Basically, anything we plug into the wall is running on AC. Audio signals are AC. I don't know if you're aware of that. DMX control signals for lighting are also AC. That's an AC wave that's going through there. Radio signals, the radios that we have, you know, those are AC. Wi-Fi signals for computers, that's all AC. And video signals are all AC as well. I can tell you about that. So when you look at an AC on a graph, and we're going to get into a little bit of this, it looks like this on a graph. Starts off at zero here, and it swings positive, then it swings negative, and positive and negative, and positive and negative, and positive. It's just continually alternating between positive and negative. That's what we call alternating current, okay? The distance between any two of the same point is called the period, okay? And that's the time it takes, the same point on the cycle. And the frequency, what they call the frequency, that's the rate at which these oscillations occur per second. So in the United States, we use 60 cycle AC. That means that this wave, oops, let me get back here. That means that this wave is oscillating up and down from here to there, which is one cycle. It's doing that 60 times per second. Up and down, 60 times per second. That's what we call 60 cycle. Other countries are on 50 cycle, okay? Mostly because 50 is divisible into 100. That's the best I can do for you, okay? The United Kingdom, Europe, China, they're all on 50 cycle power, and I believe Japan is on 50 cycle power. So we're kind of alone in the world in terms of 60 cycle. When that was established way back in the 19th century, they determined that 60 cycle was the best, and it's never been changed. Now, if you look at an AC waveform in the 60th of a second, it looks like this, okay? You can see where the voltage starts here at zero, and then it swings all the way up here, goes back to zero, all the way negative, and goes back to here. These numbers here are the cycles from 1 to 360. So those are the number of degrees that that thing is going through. And this is voltage over here. This is 0, that's up to 200 negative. 200 positive, 200 negative. This is voltage, this measurement from top to bottom. And this is time, okay, or degrees, you know, however you want to look at it. Now, this is our 0 volt reference right in the middle here. These are positive voltage, it swings positive. And then it swings negative down there. How do you measure this thing? You know? And that's the thing you wrestle with, is how do you measure something that's constantly changing? It's changing all the time. Well, if you were to measure this thing right here, and you could stick the meter on that wave right at that second, right at that moment in time, that 1/120th of a second, it would measure 0 volts. It's not very useful, you know, nothing. We know there's voltage there, but we measured it at that moment in time and it was only 0 volts. So then we think, okay, well, I'm going to measure it way up here at 90 degrees. Oh my God, it's 170 volts up there. Jeez. Does the AC in the wall really get to 170 volts? It does. It goes up to 170 volts. It doesn't stay there very long, but it goes up there. Okay. So then you think, okay, well, maybe I'll measure it down here. My God, it's minus 170 volts. Now we're getting even worse. Okay? Measure it right in the middle at 180 degrees. We're back to 0. I'm getting more confused here. If you could measure this waveform right at 135 degrees, it would measure exactly 120 watts. But that's not very useful. Okay? When you stick the meter on there, you know, you got to find a way to measure something that's always changing. And this is how you do it. What it is you have a thing called RMS. It's a little hard to see here. I should have changed that color. But it's basically 120 volts. Okay? And we're going to show you how you get that. What it is it's root mean square. Don't pay attention to any of this math. This is just for our little discussion. A lot of people think RMS is an average value. It is not an average value, okay? Because if you look at that waveform, half the time it's positive, half the time it's negative, your average is 0. It's not an average value. You'll hear people say that. Oh, it's an average value. It totally isn't, okay? It's one number to measure this constantly changing AC voltage, all right? What it is it's the equivalent to DC for equal power to an equal load, okay? We're going to show you how that works here. If you have a 120 volt DC circuit here across your load, which let's say it's a 60 watt bulb, and then you have another circuit over here that's 120 volts AC across the same 60 watt bulb, if you're putting out the same amount of power to that load, if that light is just as bright, it will be just as bright with 120 volts AC as it will on 120 volts DC. So what it is it's the equivalent to the same circuit of DC. It's equal power getting distributed to an equal size load. Now, that sounds really convenient, but again, how do you measure something that's constantly changing? Well, how you get it is kind of complicated. I'll show you a complicated way briefly and then the easy way. You can take that waveform and sample it more than 30 times, and you get a whole bunch of positive numbers and a whole bunch of negative numbers. You take them all and square them all, like this times itself. Take all those numbers and you average them together. Then you take the square root of that. My head's about to explode here with all this math, okay? You don't have to remember any of that. As you take more and more samples, okay, you can take 30, but as you take more and more samples and run it through those numbers, the number you end up with begins to approach 70.7% of the peak value of that voltage. Remember we said it was 170 volts there. And so what happens is, since it's always a positive number, the peak value and the RMS value is 70.7% of that peak voltage. Okay. So the easy way to do it is to just take the peak voltage by 0.707. 0.707 times 170 volts is 120 volts AC. and that's how you get your 120. Or what it's more common, people will say 110. You know, nowadays it's been standardized at 120, but you know, years ago it was people always say 110, 220, but it's 120 these days. Okay. Now, every AC voltmeter that we have will automatically do that calculation for you in RMS. So you stick it on there and it'll just sit there at 120, 121. It'll tell you exactly how much voltage is there and measure it in RMS. So you don't have to do any math. But you hear people talk about RMS, but they don't really have an idea of what that means. You know, it's like there's this one number to measure that AC, but what does that mean? You know, it's like saying I have $50. Well, what is a dollar? Well, it's a unit of currency. Or, you know, you have to have a little bit better handle on what these numbers mean. Everything we calculate for voltages and all of that is all in RMS. So when you hear somebody say 120 volts, that's RMS. That's every number is RMS. So we look at this thing in 1/60th of a second. We've got our 0-volt reference, peak value of 170, and our RMS value is going to be 0.707 times the peak, and 120 volts. That's how you get 120 volts of how we measure electricity in the world.